In this presentation, I will talk about the CFA Institute's Global Investment Performance Standards, or GIPS as they are often referred to. First, some context and why were these GIPS standards created? Now, an issue in the investment management industry historically has been in terms of how to report results. And as you can imagine, with the investment world becoming more global and investors essentially looking for opportunities in different countries, different regions, and if, for example, asset management companies, when they report their results, are using different standards, obviously that's a concern for an investor. So if here is an investor sitting in the US and if he's evaluating an investment management company sitting in China, and another one sitting in India, and another one sitting in Germany, and if each one of them are producing or talking about their results but using different standards, then clearly it is very hard for the investor over here to compare these different companies. So that's an issue. Obviously, it's an issue across countries, but it is also an issue within a given country if different asset management companies are presenting results but using different standards to present their results. Related to that, some companies might, when they report their results, rather than report results for all their accounts or all the investments, they might simply report based on representative accounts. So if this company in China has 50 portfolios that it manages, but it chooses only to report a representative set of 10 portfolios, obviously that will create issues. Another possible issue is survivorship bias. So if there are no clear rules about which portfolios to report on or which funds to report on, then a given asset management company might simply report the results for funds that are currently under management or portfolios that are currently under management and ignore portfolios that are no longer being managed. Now, obviously, that introduces a survivorship bias because portfolios that are not being managed are probably the portfolios that did not perform well. So clearly we need some rules that define how past portfolios, how the performance on past portfolios need to be reported. Another potential issue is varying time periods. So if company A reports based on 3 years worth of data, company B reports 5 years worth, company C reports 10 years worth, clearly for an investor that is hard to compare. So these are just some issues that have existed historically and in fact still exist today. What GIPS tries to do is essentially avoid or seek to overcome these problems. So very simplistically put, the CFA Institute has defined these global investment performance standards, where if as an investor we know a certain company, a certain asset management company is following these standards, then we essentially know what sort of a calculation they are doing to report their results. If different companies are compliant with GIPS, then we know that the results that they report can be compared, and that obviously is a huge advantage to the investor. So a few larger points related to GIPS. Number one, investment management firms can choose to comply with GIPS. So there are two key points here. Who complies with GIPS? It's not an investor, but it's the investment management firms. So GIPS essentially applies to investment management firms. It doesn't, for example, apply to brokerage houses. It would not apply to banks. So GIPS applies to firms that are managing money or managing investments, and then they need to report their performance. So GIPS applies to them. And secondly, GIPS is not mandatory. So an investment management firm can voluntarily choose whether or not to comply with GIPS. So if it's voluntary, why would a firm comply with GIPS? The simple answer is that clearly if a firm complies with gifts, then that is, then it's more likely to win more business. So if I am an investor over here and I need to decide between these three asset management companies, A, B and C, and if C is the only one that complies with GIPS, all else equal, clearly my preference would be for a company that has transparency in terms of how it is reporting results. And if it is reporting results based on a now effectively what's a globally accepted performance management or performance reporting standard, so clearly firms that comply with GIPS would be seen more favorably by the investor community. So clearly benefits the investment management firm. It also benefits the current and future clients of an investment management firm, because as I have already discussed, the clients can now more easily compare the results of different firms, and clients know exactly how and where the numbers are coming from when they see the performance results of a given asset management company. So these are some important points. Now, some terminology, and perhaps in the context of GIPS, one of the most important terms you need to know is this term called composites. So what is a composite? A composite is simply an aggregation of portfolios managed with the same investment mandate, objective or strategy. Just to understand this a little bit better, let's say that you have this portfolio management or asset management company A, which has four different portfolios, portfolio 1, 2, 3 and 4. Now let's say that the strategy and mandate for portfolio 1 and 2 is to invest in value stocks in North America, and 3 and 4, here the mandate is to invest in growth stocks in emerging markets. So just making something up over here. So funds 1 and 2 or portfolios 1 and 2 would be in a given composite, because the strategy and the mandate of these two portfolios is similar. So it makes sense to combine these in one composite and then report results for this composite. Similarly, 3 and 4 would be combined in another composite because their strategy and mandate is very similar, and then the firm, the asset management company, can report results for this composite. In the context of composites, we also need to understand two important terms, fee-paying and discretionary. So fee-paying means that this portfolio, for example, is being managed for a fee. And the point here, let's say that there is this other fund or portfolio 5 which is being done for a charity organization, and the asset management company is not charging any fee for the management of this fund. If no fee is being charged, then this particular portfolio or fund cannot be included in a composite. So that's this point. A second point is that portfolios must be discretionary. So this means that let's say that there is this other fund, fund 6, where the client is telling the asset management company what to buy, what not to buy. So let's say that this fund 6 is being managed for a bank, and the bank has given very clear instructions that we only want the money invested in short-term T-bills. So if this is the case, then from the perspective of the asset management company, clearly fund 6 is not discretionary. So this asset management company is not using its own discretion to figure out what securities or what investments to make for this fund. That is being dictated by the client. So as you might imagine, if a particular fund or portfolio is not discretionary, then it does not make sense for it to be included in a composite. So I think as far as composites go at our current level, as long as you know what I have just talked about, you are in good shape. Another general point has to do with verification. Now, a firm can claim to be GIPS compliant, and that is all right. So a firm might say it's GIPS compliant. Now, in addition to claiming that that this asset management company is GIPS compliant, it can choose to get verified by a third party. Now, verification again is voluntary and it has to be performed by a third party. What is the benefit? The benefit obviously to an investor is that if he knows that a third independent party has verified the GIPS compliance, that obviously is a positive and investors will see that favorably. But again, I want to emphasize that this is voluntary. Goals and objectives. Now, essentially, I'm not adding tremendous value here. I have simply summarized the points that you can see on page 177 of the curriculum. But I have seen questions on these goals and objectives before, so I think you should read this a couple of times. So, what are the goals of GIPS? One is to establish investment industry best practices for calculating and presenting investment performance. In a sense, we've already talked about this and hopefully it makes sense. Obtain worldwide acceptance for a single standard. So obviously this is wonderful if you can invest anywhere in the world and asset management companies are all reporting their results based on a single standard. That, as I mentioned earlier, makes comparability easier and makes life easier for investors. Number three, promote the use of accurate and consistent investment performance data. So again, this is obvious. If the performance results that are being presented are only as good as the data that is being used to create those results, and obviously what GIPS wants is that the data being used is accurate, it is consistent, and so on. So clearly this is important. Encourage fair global competition. How is GIPS encouraging fair global competition? Obviously there is a competition across different companies, across asset management companies all over the world to compete for investor funds, and the way GIPS is encouraging fair competition is by ensuring that all these asset management companies are presenting data or presenting their results in a common way using the same standard. So that makes this a relatively level playing field. And finally, to foster self-regulation. So essentially firms are being encouraged to present and report their results in a fair, honest and ethical manner. So that encourages and fosters self-regulation of the asset management community. In any case, I think as long as you read these 5 points several times, and if you just read the bullets also on page 177, I think that would be useful. Some key characteristics of GIPS. One is we need to define the firm. So if an asset management company is defining itself as or claiming GIPS compliance, we need to know what the firm is. And within a given asset management company, you might have a unit in Europe and a unit in let's say North America. Now, the question is your firm the collective unit or is it just one entity that is claiming GIPS compliance? We get into details on this in level 3. All you need to know right now is that when a given firm or entity is claiming GIPS compliance, we need to be clear on the definition of the entity. So in my simple example, we might just say that for this large asset management company, the European entity is a separate entity and it is that entity that is claiming GIPS compliance. We must include all actual fee-paying discretionary portfolios in composites for a 5-year minimum or since inception. So that's another important point. And then let's say that a company has been around for 4 years. So obviously then we need to use 4 years worth of data, and then every year we add performance results building up to a minimum of 10 years of GIPS compliant data. So essentially the point is, let's say a company has been around for 6 years, then we start with the last 5 years worth of GIPS compliant data and keep adding. If a company has only been around for 4 years, then we need to take the 4-year data, make sure it's presented in a GIPS compliant way, and then every year add data, and we need to have at least 10 years of GIPS compliant data. So if a company wants, it can then present 11 years worth of data, but it's not a GIPS requirement. Some more information on key characteristics. Certain calculations and presentation standards are required along with disclosures. So this is a general point. GIPS mandates how to calculate returns, how to present results, and so on. Input data must be accurate. That is kind of obvious. GIPS. Now, when you have, we are going to look at 9 standards over the next few slides. For every standard, there is a certain amount of required things that must be done, and then there are some recommendations. Now, in general, these recommendations, it's a good idea for firms that are claiming GIPS compliance to also follow the recommended provisions. But at this stage, we don't need to know the details of everything that's required and everything that's recommended. All you need to know is that for every standard, there are certain things that are required and there are certain things that are recommended. When I was taking the exam, we actually had to remember all these, but I think CFA Institute is now taking it a little easier on you, and you don't need to learn all the details of what's required and what's recommended. An asset management firm cannot claim partial compliance. So a firm can't complain that we are like 60% GIPS compliant. Either a firm is compliant or it's not compliant. If GIPS conflicts with local law, follow the local law but disclose conflicts. So this is consistent with what you might have seen earlier in the standards and ethics, but this is fairly self-evident. At no point does the CFA Institute want you to violate your local laws. Some fundamental responsibilities of a firm that's claiming GIPS compliance: must provide compliant presentation to all prospects, must provide a composite list and description to all prospects who make a request, and on client request, the firm must provide compliant presentation and composite description. I know I simply read that out, but there isn't a whole lot more to this. Now, what are the 9 sections of the GIPS standard? You need to just know the basics of all these standards. It starts with 0 and will go on to 8, so that makes 9 standards. The standard 0 is the fundamentals of compliance, and if of all 9, this is the only one where in the curriculum this is not part of the optional segment. So there are several details on this which I would encourage you to read, and these are given on page 183. So I think you should go over it. But if I were to summarize 2 key points from this fundamentals of compliance, we need to define the firm. So as I mentioned earlier, if a firm has a unit in Europe and a unit in North America, then we need to define whether our firm is this whole entity or whether it is the unit in Europe or so on. So anyway, the definition of the firm that is claiming GIPS compliance needs to be clearly done. The definition of discretionary. So earlier I mentioned that for a given fund or portfolio to be included in a composite, it must be discretionary. So what exactly does discretionary mean? How do we define that? That obviously is open. So that needs to be defined. As an example, if a client says that only invest in large cap stocks, now does that make the fund a discretionary fund or not? We don't need to get into details right now. All you need to know is that as part of our GIPS standards, we need to define what discretionary means. Next, input data. So input data must be consistent for full, fair, comparable performance presentation. So this is obvious. The quality of the input data must be good, it must be consistent, it must be complete, and so on. So that's easy. Number 2, calculation methodology. Certain methodologies are required. So when we calculate our returns, so if for a given composite we say that our returns on average, our return has been 8%, how do we calculate this? So that methodology must be, so there are certain methodologies required, and these methodologies need to be uniform across your different portfolios. In level 3, we will study what these methodologies are. But just to give you a simple idea right now, in quantitative methods, for example, you study different ways of presenting performance results. So just as a quick refresher from quant, I hope you recall that when you present results, you can use, for example, a time-weighted return or a money-weighted return. Now, if one asset management company is using a time-weighted return, another is using money-weighted return, then it's not easy to compare the results given by those two firms. So, very simplistically, what GIPS tells us, or tells asset management companies, for example, to use time-weighted return. You don't exactly need to know that right now. We will cover that in level 3. In fact, there is a whole study section on GIPS in level 3. Number 3, composite construction. So composites, when we create the composites, must be meaningful asset weighted composites. Essentially, all you need to know here is that we need to be careful about the construction of our composites. I have already talked about what a composite is. This is basically a combination of portfolios which have the same objective and mandate. And again, any fund or portfolio in the composite must be discretionary and it must be fee paying. Next, disclosures. So when we present our results, there must be some disclosures. So this information must be disclosed about the firm's presentation and policies. Presentation and reporting. So this is the heart and soul of our performance, where we actually present, the asset management company actually presents investment performance according to the GIPS requirements. Number 6. So now 6, 7 and 8, these are add-ons to items 0 through 5 that I've already talked about. Essentially, what we are seeing here is, what 6 is saying is that for real estate investments, there are certain additional provisions or certain additional performance related items that need to be considered, and the details of those additional items that are specific to real estate are defined in standard 6. Similarly, for private equity, there are certain quirks about private equity that you will study in level 2, but all you need to know right now is that there are certain ways of presenting private equity performance results, and those are outlined in segment 7. Wrap fee / SMA portfolio. The way you can think of this is, there might be certain managed portfolios, and these portfolios, they will have a certain annual fee, management fee, etc. So all those collectively is called wrap fee, and sometimes these portfolios where we have a wrap fee are called a wrap fee portfolio or a SMA, separately managed account portfolio. And there might be certain quirks or certain performance reporting items related to these portfolios which are not covered explicitly in 0 through 5. So those need to be mentioned here. If you are itching to get the details, there are several pages of optional stuff which explain standards 1 through 8 in a lot more detail, and that starts on page 185. You can browse through these pages very quickly just to get an idea, but it is not necessary to know this material for the exam. Now, I would encourage you to do one more thing. I think what you should do is just look at one GIPS performance standard, and if you go to page 224 in the curriculum, what you will notice is a sample compliant presentation. And in sample 1, you will see the presentation for a investment firm balanced growth composite. So you will notice here that data is presented from 1st January 2002 through 31st December 2011. So that's 10 years worth of data. We see various return numbers for those 10 years. And then I want you to also read the notes at the bottom. So in the notes, they, for example, define what this composite is all about, and they give several other pieces of information. I think if you go through this one sample, it will basically help you understand the material that we have spoken about.